And that is true. That is true. David found friends and foe, and here is the man, the little boy. And David does something very important at this time, and I want you to really understand it. When Saul starts speaking to David, Saul says, you know, this guy is so experienced. You know, don't do it. Just, what are you doing, David? You know, and he gave him some good advice. You cannot go against his resume. You're going to lose every which way. Just let them be. You know, maybe they'll get tired and they'll go back home, you know. All their food is going to run out. In fact, the fight was nearer to Jerusalem and to Israel than it was to the Philistine camp. He was sensible. He was pragmatic, you know, but Saul was wrong. He was wrong. And you see, here comes a big lesson for us men. Those of us that like leadership, that really want to be a leader in a church, or be a leader at home, or be a leader of our country. Oh, mama, listen to this very carefully. You know, now that, you know, the reason I say that, because, you know, I heard that my sermon is going all over the internet, so I got to be careful. But the issue is this, not a team, not a church. It doesn't happen. Not a nation. Nobody, not your CEO, nobody will surpass the leadership that is in charge. Nobody. We cannot do better than that person when they're not leading us right. So if you see a church that is all messed up and a church that is fighting amongst each other, whatever, I look at the pastor, but I look at the leadership and I say, that's a messed up leadership. Because a church will never go above and beyond that which the leaders have. And that was the problem with Israel. Saul was the leader. They could not ascend. They could not do the brave heart thing, you know, and really go against great odds and give them a great speech and we're going to go and run for our death. He couldn't do that. He was not willing to die. He was not willing to pay the price. But David was, and once he couldn't, you know, and David told him, listen, you know, I want to tell you a story. I want to tell you a story. I am a shepherd boy, and I'm out there alone. And it's very interesting in this particular story. Come with me to Samuel chapter 17. I'm just relating a story you guys know from a long time, you know. Verse 34, the servant used to keep sheep for his father. And when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, David says, I went, verse 35, I went after him and struck him and delivered it out of his mouth. And if he arose against me, I caught these animals by the beard and struck him and killed him. Your servant has struck both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, for he has defied the living God. He recounts a story, just like God has told Israel again and again and again. The reason there are Ten Commandments, well, let me explain to you why there are Ten Commandments. You were once slave in Egypt. And this is the reason I want you to put it in your forehead, is because once you were a slave and you were asking for deliverance for 400 years, and God came and delivered you, and you continued to groan through that major journey in the desert, and God sent a major cloud in the day and a pillar of fire at night. You were warm and you didn't have sunburn, and retell the story of God, the sacred story. Retell it, man. He was retelling the story of how God delivered these ferocious animals into his hand because those were his father's sheep. And he was not about to lose a sheep on his watch. And verse 37 is the biggest key. And if you can remember this, remember it for the rest of your life. And David said, the Lord who delivered the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go and the Lord be with you.
Amen.
If God did it for me before, he can do it again later on.
Amen.
He will do it. What a fantastic. This is only something that can come out of experience. Not out of a Bible study. Not about being a vegan. No. Not about keeping one commandment and feeling that you're okay, because you have traversed and you have conquered that one commandment. No. This comes from an experience in life that you cannot buy or sell. It's an experience where he then flourished where God had him. It's an experience of him being content with his father's job for him. There are some people, I got to tell you, there are some men that I have known. I'm not women, we're not dealing about women today. But some men that I have known that no matter what position we give them, they're never content. They always look for that power, and they always look for that control, and if they cannot do it in their jobs, they do it in their homes. Lo and behold, look at their kids sometimes. That is a picture of father at home. They are men that are never, they never will be content with what God has given them. And lo and woe to the woman who marries a guy like that. Because if he's not content with his job, and he's not content with the place that God has given him, do you think, ladies, he's going to be content with you? He's not going to be content with you. That's the price of not flourishing where God has you at this moment. I'm in the military just like Chaplain Monroe. And it's amazing. When we see chaplains, those people that are faithful, that do not make it to the next rank, how cantankerous and how ugly and how terrible and miserable they get when they don't make it to the next, because they paid everything that they had to do and they went in 5-10 deployments. And it's amazing, and woe be to us when we work under the leadership and guidance of somebody like that. Some of you know, you don't have to be in the military. Some of you know people just like that. They didn't get their due, they didn't get their promotion, and now the dog is paying for it, the wife is paying for it, the cat is paying for it, and the children are paying for it. Rather than waiting upon God's time. God had chosen a king for Israel when that king was only a young man and a shepherd boy. He was not wanting positions. But this king said something very important. He was not going to stand by the wayside when somebody was breaking and messing up the reputation of God. He was not willing to do that. And the Bible says, okay, so David, here is the next thing you got to do. You got to wear that. I mean, if you're going to go against this guy, you got to wear the best of the best. Why don't you wear my stuff? The stuff that nobody has in this army. Wear my armor, David. And the Bible says he tried it. He tried it. He couldn't move. He didn't know where the sword was. What's going on? No. Forget about it. I need to be myself. If you're going to slay a giant, if you're going to do this, you've got to be then free to be yourself. And the Bible says he took the staff and he took the sling and he went to the brook and took 5 smooth stones. And he went down. And when Goliath saw this young man, he couldn't believe his eyes. You know, am I a dog that this kid is coming? He is asking for 40 days, give me a man. And they sent to him a handsome, ruddy boy. And he could not believe his eyes. And he says, I'm going to feed you to the flesh. And David says, no, no, I'm going to kill you and all the armies here that you have there. They're going to be food for the birds of the air. Everybody, you're wanting to kill me? No, everybody's going down. And the Bible says that when Goliath got mad, he encroached there. And David, rather than doing, you know, one of these, because he's lighter, he's younger, and he's faster, rather than doing a football type of move, he goes after the guy, swinging now his sling. And the researchers say that a sling of the type of David at that time was getting hit with an 80 mile an hour baseball in the head. And when he sent that projectile with the speed of angels, the projectile went right into his frontal lobe, encrusted in there, and the giant, like that song, went down and down, right into his face. And David immediately did not do like the Titanic. Here's an iceberg. Let's go left. Let's go right. And maybe we'll hit the Titanic by the side. No. Met the problem head on really quickly. He took the sword of Goliath. He stood and then cut his head and brought his head to Saul. That is a man that did not need all the equipment and all the resources that this life can bring you.
Amen.
No, 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 no. Some come with spears and some come with swords. But David says, I come in the name of the Lord God Almighty. Everybody was worshiping this man. I mean, to talk about Goliath, he was a god. There was nobody like him. And everybody was scared, including God's people. Just like the children this morning got so excited about Captain America, everybody got excited about Goliath. Even his foes have respect for this guy. And I ask you, gentlemen, today, what is your idol? Is your idol football? Is your idol sports? I was once attending a church here in town for a little bit, and I just couldn't remember through football season, after the sermon and after all this stuff and all the